Now, Andrew Griffith has had a horrible childhood, but he hasn't let his past define his future. He says many of us live with the limiting belief that the world revolves around us, and he joins us now to dispel what he calls the me myth. Hello, Andrew.
Hello, Stephen. How are you doing?
Oh, good. How are you?
I'm excellent, thanks. You're not going to make me tap dance, are you?
Nah, we're going to do that for other hosts. So just to define for us, so we all know what we're talking about, what is the me myth?
Well, exactly as you said, it's when we live with what I believe is a very limiting belief that the world does revolve around me. And I think that there's so many of us that are searching for happiness and for contentment in our life. I believe that you cannot find that if you live with that limiting belief. So I wrote a book about it and made many suggestions on how to change the way we think.
Where does it come from, though? Does it come from our parents or our friends, this whole self-belief?
Well, I think that in some ways it can be positive coming from your parents.
Yeah.
I think that to have that self-belief, but I think it's a little bit different. I think the world we live in, we are bombarded with communication from various, you know, thousands and thousands of different areas, and a lot of those messages are telling us what to think, how to feel, where to live, what to buy, all the rest of it. And I think we get a little bit overwhelmed with these particular messages that are coming through, and it does start to make us think that we are the epicenter of the universe.
Yeah.
And the problem with that is we forget what it is we really want. We lose track. We're told many, many times that you need to think this way, so you start to think that way.
You've got some great advice in the book, though. One of the things being let go of the past. Let's look at your past. Tell us about your childhood, because that was outrageous.
Well, I had an unusual childhood, I guess. I mean, I haven't got a birth certificate. I don't know when I was born. I don't know where I was born. I was around Melbourne in Australia, but I was brought up by a wonderful yet crazy old lady, you know, who was 75 years old, and she took in a six-month-old baby, myself and my sister, who was 18 months old at the time. And we lived in this strange world with a lot of violence. And I mean, I slept on a balcony until I was like 10 or 11.
Yeah.
I wasn't allowed to sleep inside, and I used to wander the streets of Perth. That was my upbringing. We washed once a week, whether we needed to or not. I didn't brush my teeth till I was about 9. You know, so you can imagine I was a fairly attractive person to be around. But she had dementia, so I would be woken up in the night being beaten unconscious, literally, with lumps of wood, and have boiling water poured on me and stabbed with scissors, and, you know, just a very traumatic childhood. And of course, I followed a fairly predictable path of getting into drugs and alcohol, and I was heading down that road until I was about 17, and I had an amazing epiphany and realised that I was in control of my life and I could make these changes, and I did, and that was the beginning of a long journey where I really let go of my past. I wasn't going to let it tell me what the rest of my life was going to be like.
You referred to the older woman who raised you as wonderful throughout the book, and I was like, how can you think that? But then you had a real breakthrough moment when you finally saw your mother's side of the story as well.
Absolutely, and a big part of the me myth is about letting go of the past and learning to empathise and to really put yourself in other people's shoes. Now, this old biddy that brought us up, yes, there was a really dark side to her, but there was an amazingly wonderful side to her as well. Did you look at? She took us in for starters. We were always well fed. We were, you know, there was no real show of sign or affection or love or certainty. And I know it's hard for people to think, how can you have nice feelings towards someone who was so violent towards you? But I can harbour resentment. I can harbour anger. I could be angry at my mother. How could she leave us? But I understand that what she did at the time, a 17-year-old kid with two children in a bad relationship herself, was probably the greatest act of love that a mother could do. She didn't know this old lady was like that. She left us with this grandmotherly type of woman up the road and disappeared. And you look at that and go, wow, when I looked at it, life and her decisions from her point of view, I asked myself, what would I do if I was 17 with a couple of kids in a bad relationship and there was a lady up the road who looked beautiful and caring, and I'd probably do the same, you know, thinking I was acting out of love. So, and a lot in life is like that. We've got to learn to look at other people's situations. It's not just all about me.
You've got some great advice in there as well. Other things, find out what your dreams are and actually go for them. Don't stay back. Go for your dreams.
Absolutely. And I think so many of us have the dreams almost beaten out of us in life. And whilst I'm not a believer that if you just sit on the couch and pick fluff out of your belly button and want to be a millionaire, it will happen, I think you've got to actually get involved and do it. But I'm a big encourager of helping people to get their dreams. Letting people think big, you know, dream big. And things start to happen, Steve. It starts to become a reality, but we should. It's like celebrating. I think we've lost the art of celebration. We should be jumping up and down at the opening of an envelope these days, if you ask me. I think the global financial crisis has taken away, stole Christmas last year, and it's taken away a lot of our enjoyment. And we don't need to just celebrate, you know, the huge things. I think we need to give people a pat on the back a lot more and say, job well done, or thank you, and celebrate some of the smaller things in life. And it's amazing how your life changes when you go around celebrating other people, being grateful for what other people are doing, even serving other people and showing that there's some wonderful things to be obtained by being self-sacrificing, being humble and generous with your time, with your money, with whatever it may be. And ironically, that to me is the greatest way to lead a wonderful, rich and fulfilling life, is to give as much as you possibly can of everything that you have.
You're incredibly honest about yourself in the book. You talk about your failed relationships, about your health issues, about your childhood as well. Is it hard? Because I feel like I know everything about you now, Andrew.
I know. There's no mystery left in our relationship, is there? It's interesting. I was probably quite a closed book, to use a terrible metaphor, for many years. But I realised a few years back that I started to share some of my past with people. I was actually talking at an event. Did you read that part?
Yeah, and the guy got really upset.
Yeah, and they said, oh, can you tell us about your past? Yeah. And I'd never done that. So I got up and spent an hour telling these people, and there's just this look of amazement on people's faces when I told them all about my background. And these were people I knew for a long time, and a good friend of mine stormed out of the room and on his way out saying to me, Andrew, I've known you for 20 years and it took 45 minutes. So in 45 minutes, I've learnt more about you in that time than I have in the last 20 years. And I felt quite embarrassed and upset. And then I changed my ways and I started talking to people and sharing my own experiences. But the greatest gift for me is to realise that how that inspires others. When they realise you can, I'm not an educated man, I've made plenty of mistakes in my life, but I've overcome them. I've kept trying to make myself a better man, and people find that inspiring. And I feel a little bit guilty because I think every time I share part of my story, I feel better. You know, I almost get more out of it than the people that I'm sharing with. But it's a wonderful gift, I think, to be able to share your background and have it to make a difference in other people's lives.
And take away the power of it as well. Living honestly is the best way. Andrew, it's a great book. Thank you so much for joining us today and telling your story as well.
Well, thank you very much, Steve. I really appreciate the opportunity, and it was lovely to talk with you.
No worries. Have a great time. Thanks, Andrew.
Thank you.